My dad was an avid outdoorsman. If it wasn't fishing, it was collecting butterflies or nuts or hiking in the woods or something every weekend. He had strict rules though. Every weekend was one day for home improvements and one day for the out of doors. So that he always instilled a great love of fishing in me from the earliest ages. Well, I don't want to say that I was addicted to the fishing scene, but I rigged my own ballyhoo and caught a sailfish on it in January 1957. I was 8 years old and we'd been here for exactly a year, and I already caught a sailfish on a ballyhoo that I rigged myself, so.
Awesome.
I was studying everything there was to read about South Florida fishing, and when I was real little, there was a TV show, The Adventures of Crunch and Dez, and that was late at night, and my parents would wake me up to watch that program. That's how important fishing was to me. I was totally addicted to fishing, and I think I was 13, maybe, no, I was 13, and I was at the Newport Fishing Pier all the time. Back then it was called Sunny Isles Pier. It's 163rd and Collins, and I was there every weekend and all day, every day in the summertime. I ride my bike down and I'd either ride home or my mom would come and pick me up. But they had to rotate their vacations. So they asked me if I would be the bait man in the summertime while they were short on staff. So I was the bait man on the pier. And then when I was 15, New Year's Eve day, one of my buddies came to me and says, I have to work on a headboat tonight and I don't want to do it. Would you please come and cover for me? But don't tell him you're only 15. And I worked on the Mucho K on New Year's Eve. So that was my first day on a job on a boat. And as soon as I was 16, I was working on the party boats all the time, every chance I got. I don't want to say I was fishing too much, but the boats did a night trip from 8 to midnight, and when I was a senior in high school, my father finally called the boat and said that if I worked on a school night one more time, he was going to have the police come arrest the crew for contributing to the delinquency of a minor, and they kicked me off the boat. I could only fish on Friday and Saturday nights then. I was working at Pier 5 down in downtown Miami, where Bayside is now. And I was working on a drift boat called the Seabreeze, and I was the night mate, and every afternoon we sold fish on the dock that we had caught the night before. And Tommy Silvano was running the Seagull Junior, and he came down to the head boat when we were selling fish, and he says, and you guys know how to wrap wire? And I says, of course we all know how to wrap wire, we're fishermen. He says, anybody know how to fish a wire line? I says, no, but we can fish anything else. I said, sir, we can figure it out. Does anybody want to work on my boat tomorrow? I says, I'm there. Yeah, I'll be there. What time? You got to be there at 6:30 in the morning. I says, great. We get done here at 1:30. I'll be there at 6:30. And from there, I went to work in the head boat at night and the charter boat in the daytime. So my hours of employment were 7 a.m. to 5 p.m., 5 p.m. to 1:30 a.m. and back to work 7 a.m. the next day. And I did that for almost a year. And on my day off, I'd go down to the Keys and fish off the bridges. There's nothing about that hasn't changed. As an example, when I started on charter boats, every bait was rigged on 15 feet of number 7 piano wire, which was about 110-pound test. Bright silver wire that rusted if you didn't take good care of it. We were using 8-0 and 9-0 triple strength needle eye hooks. And we were trolling ballyhoo almost exclusively with some bonita strips thrown into the mix. Today, if we're going sail fishing, trolling or live baiting, the leaders are 30, 40, or 50 pound test monofilament or fluorocarbon. The hooks are 3-0. To 7-0 light wire circle hooks. Back then they were J hooks. And the line back then was 60 or 80 pound test. And now the line is typically 20 pound test. So it's drastically changed just in sailfish. In electronics, it's a total joke. In 1968, I was at the Castaways charter boat dock, 30 world-class charter boats, and there was a total of one depth finder.
Wow.
And there was no Loran or GPS at all. And that was the way it was. And when I bought my first charter boat, it had a flasher that went around and around in circles, and it would flash at zero and it would flash to the depth if you were lucky.
Wow.
And then we progressed to paper machines that were off of that flasher, and the lines could be angled like a wreck when it was going. It was crazy, but really different than today's electronics. Well, you know, it's an interesting quandary that we get into, because you hear about guys today catching 20 sailfish a day quite frequently. But back in the late 60s and early 70s, the sailfish bite was on. The wind was out of the north, and they were biting all the way from Palm Beach to Key Largo. The whole range of your radio, they'd be catching sailfish. Now, from the sea buoy for a mile south, the sailfish are biting like crazy. But if you're not right there, they're not biting very good. So back then, it was nobody caught 20 sailfish because the hooks were too big and the wire was too heavy, but everybody had real good sail fishing. Now, it sounds like it's fantastic, but it's a very finite, small area. So where you could point at and say, oh, the fishing's much better, I really worry about it all the time. And because I worry about it all the time, I became a great advocate of circle hooks. And now I'm doing everything in my power to push people to realize that if you break the line on a sailfish, or you cut the leader up at the snap swivel, or anything that leaves a line on a sailfish more than about 3 feet long, the odds are that sailfish is dead. Because in all of our fishing, in all the fish that we catch, we have never caught a sailfish with a piece of line longer than his body. It's like something like 10,000 sailfish. And we've never caught a sailfish with a long piece of line hanging off of it. He's got to be a great entertainer. Because no matter how good the fishing can be, there are times when the fish don't bite. So you've got to be able to explain to people how to drop back, how their reels work, what happened on the greatest day you ever had, what some of the craziest things that have happened to you have been, and throw in a few jokes besides. And then when they do catch a fish, one of the things I see that's the saddest is that a crew member will watch a person wind in a barracuda. Now the guy's from Ohio, and he's caught a pike before. So if he got a chance to see the teeth on a barracuda, and the spots and the scales and the shape of the tail, he could really relate to it. So when that guy catches that fish, don't reach over the side, cut it loose and say, oh, nice job, you just caught a barracuda. Put your rod in the holder, get out of the chair, come on here, look at the teeth on this guy. You see those black spots? Those are false eyes, so that when a shark comes after him, he doesn't know whether he's coming or going, he doesn't know where to strike him. You see how broad that tail is? That broad tail is a power tail. It's not as fast as a sharp fork tail, but it has a lot more power. Therefore, they can kick twice and they're in the air, or they can instantly start and strike a bait from a standing position. And conversely, if it's a sailfish, A.B. Raymond fishes with me every day. He shows them the slot that the dorsal fin goes in, the slit that the ventral fins go in. He shows them how the tails, not caudal peduncles, but those, I don't know if they're called last dorsal and ventral fins, or anal fins are what they're called, but those fins right back toward the back act, and the roughness of the bill on the top and smooth on the bottom, and explain to them how they put their bill down on a bait and thrust forward and steer it into their mouth. So instead of just catching a fish, educating the person on what they've caught, it makes a big, big difference, and it makes their day more memorable. I've always loved the challenges of learning new methods and new types of fish, and and how to catch them. And that's another thing that irritates greatly on a charter boat. We go sail fishing and there's no current, there's no wind, and 50 boats aren't catching any sailfish, and all of a sudden, hey, let's leave a couple sailfish baits out, but we'll put a bait down on the bottom. The other day we caught a genuine red snapper and some giant yellow eye snappers and some Almaco jacks. Whether tourists from up north, catching a sailfish is like getting a deer or an antelope or something like that, but when you switch over to putting a dead mackerel or bonita out there on some 10 wire and a 50 pound outfit, and the guy catches a 7 or 8 foot hammerhead shark or sandbar shark, now he's dealing with lions, tigers, and bears. He's really catching the apex predator. So as long as whatever you're catching, as long as you show respect for it, your customers from wherever they are really gonna enjoy what they catch. It's the biggest crime that happens in fishing is crew members that don't show respect for what isn't their target species. It's such a shame that even little kids, they don't care what they catch. But if you told them, oh, that fish is no good, well, then sooner or later they're gonna believe that a remora is no good. If you show them that the remora can suck onto the side of the boat and that sneaker on top of his head, then even a remora is a great fish. So when you're chartering a boat or going on somebody else's boat, especially if you're chartering, know who owns the fish. There's nothing worse than taking people out, and we hear it all the time, people that they went out on a charter boat and they caught an offshore barracuda. What the heck is that? And then they get back and they're showing pictures to the bartender. He says, oh my gosh, that was a wahoo. That is such good eating. Now the guy is going back down to the dock looking to hang the mate on the boat. Because first he lied to him about what he caught, and then he beat him out of his fish dinner. If the boat is going to keep half the fish and sell them, tell the charter. The boat's going to keep half the fish and sell them. If you're chartering a boat, ask them, who owns the fish? Oh, you keep some, what is your percentage of the fish? Oh, I get a gallon of fillets caught someday, and you're going to keep the ones I just caught? That don't work. If I only get a gallon of fillets, I want fillets from the fish that I caught. Don't give me amberjack when I caught black grouper. And then when you do get people on the boat, as a charter boat operator, I've always taken the attitude to treat those people like you. This is your first opportunity to make a lifetime customer. If you treat your people like I'm going to get all I can out of your wallet and run you off, then you're only going to have that customer one day. AB and I, we have the same customers out of 300 days we fish during the year. At least 100 of them are repeat customers, and another 50 or 75 are referrals from our old customers. So
sure.
Build your business. It's really good for you.